Good morning, Eagle Church. How are we this morning? Great, let's stand to our feet.
Nothing that I can't do. It's not a mountain that
Amen. I requested this this next song for us to sing this morning. I think it's a testimony to how much I like it, because I usually don't say anything about what we sing. But this next song is one of my favorite songs, I think, and I think it's neat. It was written in 2019, and you would think it was written right now, just kind of based on where we are in the world. But there's a prophetic aspect of this song being written prior to 2020, in my opinion. I love the idea. It says he is David's root at one point in this song. And I love that idea because Jesus is in the line of David. He follows David, but he also precedes David. He is the root of David. He is the offspring of David. And that tells me that Jesus is before all things and after all things, in heaven and on earth. Y'all sing this with us. Thank you. Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all maybe?
We do.
Is all creation groaning? To be the light within our midst. Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? The Father truly loves us.
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And as Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those He loves.
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. From every people and tribe, nation and tongue, He has made us a kingdom of priests to God, to reign with the Son. Is He worthy? Is He worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is He worthy? Is He worthy? Is He worthy? I thank you that you are worthy, worthy of all of our lives and all of our worship. Amen. Y'all can be seated.
Hi, Eagle Church. I am coming to you actually from Croatia. I'm with our intern, Aaron. And I wanted to just share with you a little bit about our Izvor Film Festival, which is going to be coming to completion next Monday on October 24th. But we just wanted to tell you a little bit about what it's done for our work in Sarajevo over the last 10 years. So one of the great things it's done is that it's allowed us to meet a lot of high school students, to share with them and allow them to be creative and think about things in maybe a more positive way than they have before, to learn about filmmaking, to work with people who are leading in the industry or have been working in the film industry for decades in the Balkans. But also it's allowed us to go into schools and to get to meet administrators there and teachers and build relationships with them.
So if we break down the film festival into mere numbers, we've had more than 160 students be a part of the program over the last 10 years. We've partnered with 14 schools. We've had 10 additional community service projects, as well as exhibitions from students at the schools. And we've had many students who have continued to partner with us in different ways as they've gone through college and now are out in the working world. And so we're excited about that. We love the fact that we also have a chance to build relationships with administrators and teachers in the schools, as well as other people from the film industry. So when we look at all this, it's so worth the time that we put in it, even though it can be hectic. This has been a crazy week, but we love seeing what God is doing and the way that He's allowing us to be a long-term part of so many of these people's lives. And so as we look at a number, though, that is really important to us is, what does this all cost us? So it cost about $5,000 a year to put it on. And then this year we're hoping to expand into a program where every other month they get together. We invite students from the schools to come with a film industry expert and watch a movie together in the local theater, and then be able to have sort of a critical discussion about that afterwards. And so if you want to be a part of that, that also is probably going to cost another $1,000 to $2,000. So today, I believe that you are taking a special offering to try to help us out with offsetting the cost of the film festival as well as this additional program. So I thank you so much. We're excited to have the team come and join us soon. And thank you for the stuff that the kids ministry is also collecting for us, as well as maybe some of your small groups. Thank you for praying. And thank you always, of course, for supporting me and the work that I do and the rest of our team here in Bosnia Herzegovina.
Today we'll be in Mostar, transitioning from Mostar to Sarajevo, where we'll spend the week with Petula at the center. So what she's talking about is really core to the mission in Bosnia. If you think back in the 90s, when that country was really just obliterated, both physically as well as generationally. It's a country, if you could imagine, you know, growing up people now, you know, 30 years later, who didn't have the culture, they didn't have the resources that we kind of take for granted. Things like how to interact with people, how to disagree without fighting, some of those basic things. And the community center that Petula and her team have set up is really focused around just helping fill in the gaps for those skills, helping show the young people, high school, college, out of college age, how to develop some of those skills so that they can have a future and be a part of rebuilding that country. So our team's going to be there in a couple weeks. What Petula is referring to, this film festival, is a really great way for them to make connections in the community, love on people while they're supporting the local Bosnian churches. So this week, she mentioned a special offering. Any funds that you either, if you go online and designate to the Global Ministry Fund, anything tagged to that this week will go directly to the Bosnia Film Festival. And then if you write a check, if you just want to write Bosnia or Film Festival or Petula in the memo line, then that's how you can designate those funds. So it's a really cool thing that we've got going on. Here in a couple weeks, Sarah, Kate, myself, and Isaac will be there doing some one-on-one English classes. We're going to do a lot of prayer walking around the city, just, you know, praying for the Christian message to rise up and help, you know, combat or balance against the Muslim message that's so strong there, as well as teach a couple classes around, like, how to how to have healthy conflict with someone, how to disagree without being unhappy, and some of those softer skills that Sarah and Kate are going to lead us on. So with that, I just want to pray over that, and then we'll have the Remkes come up for our scripture. So God, we just pray for what's going on in Bosnia right now. We thank you for people like Petula, who has dedicated her life to just leading and loving people over there. God, we know that we're just part of your work, and we thank you in advance for the blessings that come from that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. We are the Remkes. I am John. This is my wife, Alex. I volunteer in middle school, and she helps out with kids ministry. We also lead a Friday night small group, and we are going to read the lesson. She's actually going to read it. We're going to save you guys for me. So when she's done, she's going to say, "This is the word of the Lord," and you respond with, "Thanks be to God." And who day?
Okay. So we're reading Romans 6, 1 through 7 today. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who are baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, John and Alex. Apparently, John does not get the stage dress code. Orange and black is not acceptable. This week has been some exciting news for the Eagle family. We have new babies, three. And this is what eventually happens after you have 11 weddings. Eventually, that starts to catch up into babies coming in. So do we have pictures? We have Joe and Charity Stilbolt gave birth this week to Miles Lee. We can applaud each and every one of them. Clint and Lauren McNamara welcome son Samuel Austin. And Andrew and Megan Stelweg welcome daughter Kendall. It is a joy. Now, with that, these babies are going to find their way to the nursery. The nursery is going to need some more helpers. They're going to grow up and enter into Eagles Kids. Eagles Kids can always use more volunteers. So the more kids we pump into them, the more adults they need to volunteer. So if you would like to volunteer, this is just a shameless plug. If you would like to volunteer for Eagle Kids, reach out to Kim Shepson or Natalie Hummer, and they'll get you hooked up. Father, this morning we have come and we celebrate these new lives. And Father, you have developed them. They are fearfully and wonderfully made. We thank you for the health. We thank you for the families that you have gifted them to. Father, may we as a church be a church where they can grow up, mature, accept you, find you as Lord and Savior. And Father, just develop fully in their own spiritual walk. Father, we just pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I remember moving through the pandemic. Anybody remember the pandemic? Is it all right here? PTSD maybe occasionally. But I remember moving through the pandemic, and when we reached kind of 2021, there was a phrase that kept popping up in conversation. Maybe it was just within pastors as we're talking about church and how are you doing? At this point, I was back in Muncie in Yorktown, and we would meet with area pastors once a month, and we'd say, okay, how you doing? What are you doing? How are you doing this? And invariably during the conversation, the phrase would pop up, what is the new normal? right? What is the new normal? What is going to be happening? Which just after the pandemic, we're going to be different. Society is going to be different. Culture is going to be different. We've experienced things that we're not going to go back to the way it was in February of 2020. And we wondered what this new way would be. How would we live? What changes would take place that 5, 10 years from now we'd look back and they were just normal, right? New things come up, it just becomes normal, part of our normal routine. We know that we can't go back to the way it was before. Society's too different. Culture's too different. Our new normal, one of the things that we've discovered our new normal is, for many churches, is online church. Right? We very, very few were doing online church in February 2020. Some churches were. I think Eagle was. Muncie was. We were already doing it online. But in March of 2020, every pastor was a televangelist. Every pastor was being watched on a screen somewhere. How many of you know the name Steve and Tamara Toddy? Do you know the Toddies? The Toddies were a part of the Eagle family for many years. They were married here. Eric performed the wedding ceremony for Steve and Tamara. And in 2019, Steve and Tamara moved to Coronado, California. And while they're there trying to get settled in, learning their community, getting settled into a new job, new neighborhood, and then the start of trying to find a new church, they relied some on what was familiar. They tuned in. And then COVID hit. Everything shut down. There was no new churches to go visit. And they stayed connected online. I reached out to Steve and Tamara this week, and here is Stephen's words. He said, "We have struggled to find a church home in the San Diego area, so in that sense, it has been nice to remain connected to Eagle. Our normal routine is to watch Eagle at 7 a.m., 3-hour time difference. How many of you, if we had a 7 o'clock service, would be here?" I see a lot of no shaking head. They get up at 7 a.m. They print off copies of the note sheets for each one of them. And then when that's all over, then they try to attend a local service later in the morning. For example, today, they're watching Eagle right now. And then they're going to walk to a small Baptist church near where they live for their 10 a.m. service. So here's what I want to do. I want to give a shout out to the Toddies this morning. Will you do that? On the count, they're watching. On the count of 3, I want everyone to yell, "Good morning, Toddies." All right? 1, real loud. 2, 3.
Good morning, Toddies.
There you go. All the way to San Diego, California. You know, we have the new normal in church, and if you're with us online this morning, we are thrilled that you are a part of what we are doing here this morning. In fact, we would love to hear from you. We don't want just invisible people. We don't want just, you know, 65 devices. We want names. We want stories that are connected to those. If you can just reach out to us with a story, maybe next week you get the shout out, okay? And we'll recognize you. But this morning, we're going to discover that Paul is outlining for us a new normal for every believer. This morning's message is really for the believer. If you've accepted Christ, if you have put your faith in Jesus, as Eric talked about a couple weeks ago or last week, this is for you. Listen up. Now, if you've not placed, if you're still wondering, you're still searching, you're still, listen up still. It might be helpful somewhere down the road. But Romans probably is my favorite book of the entire Bible. And chapters 5, 6, 7, and 8 are my favorite parts of this favorite book. So buckle up, because we're going to go through what this new normal is. Paul is systematically walking us through what life lived by faith in Jesus. I love that Eric emphasized that it's in Jesus, because society puts a lot of faith in a lot of things. Many put faith in faith. Well, if I just believe, well, what are you putting your faith in? It's faith in Jesus. It's not faith for faith's sake. It's faith in Jesus. And after his introduction of himself in chapter 1, Paul describes what life before Jesus, or what life without Jesus, was like. Do you remember that sermon 2 weeks ago? Or maybe you've just tried to forget it because it wasn't a real pretty picture. The whole wrath of God thing, the godlessness, the wickedness, the suppressing of the truth. Life is one of searching and meaning and purpose and always coming up short and not quite having all the answers and sometimes not even knowing all the questions. And it is this suppression of truth which leads to distorted thinking and darkens our hearts. See, we learned in the Worldview Foundations class this morning that this world, our culture, is built on ideas. And ideas have consequences. And bad ideas have bad consequences. Life without Jesus is a bad idea. That's all very bad news. That's the picture of humanity in our culture today, totally separated from God. Then Paul describes a life that turns to Jesus in chapters 3, 4, and 5, where the personal wickedness is replaced with the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus. A righteousness that through faith is freely given. That's grace. By definition, you can't earn it. You can't earn the righteousness of God. You can't earn salvation. You can't earn grace. It's all on account of Jesus' work on the cross, his atonement. Jesus paid the ransom price, the price for our sin. And by faith in Jesus, we have forgiveness. We have new life given to us, new hope, new meaning, new purpose. And that's all what we call good news. And then in chapter 6, Paul begins to explain what this new life that we have been given looks like. It's different from chapter 1. Chapter 1 and chapter 2 is all about condemnation, bad news. Chapter 3, 4, and 5 is all about salvation, justification, good news. Chapter 6, 7, and 8 is all about sanctification, great news. Sanctification is that big church word that means the process of being made holy. See, because once we put our faith in Christ, the righteousness of God comes in, and the Holy Spirit comes in, brings it with him, and begins to do a work, a transforming work in our life. Paul is saying that crossing that line of faith, stepping into a loving, forgiving relationship with Jesus, experiencing all of the blessings of chapter 5, the peace, the grace, the hope, the victory, the love, the presence of the Holy Spirit, salvation, assurance, joy, reconciliation with God, the list goes on and on and on. Paul is saying that this life is different than anything you have ever experienced and should be lived differently than you were living before. For the believer, Jesus is a new normal. For the next three chapters, 6, 7, and 8, Paul is going to describe this new normal, or what should be the normal Christian life. Paul wants everyone to understand that we can and should live as one delivered from sin. Snatched out, bought back, that's redemption. We were bought back from sin. Slaves to sin, under the power and the authority of sin, no ability to not sin. Jesus enters in and begins that transformation, declares us immediately righteous, perfect, approved by God. Where once sin was normal, now righteousness through Christ is to be the norm. Sin is not normal for the believer. Sin is not normal for the follower of life. This for the follower of Christ, this new relationship with Jesus, based on faith, ushers in this new normal life. And how you once thought, how you once behaved, how you once related to people has entered into a process of change. Life will not be the same. And we can't go back to the way it was. I can't go back to my sinful life. Well, I can, but I shouldn't. I shouldn't even want to go back to the way it was. For the things that I have found in Jesus, life is different. So what is this new normal for the Christian? Three things that Paul mentions here in these verses. We read 1 through 7. We're going to look at 1 through 14 this morning. Three things that he mentions that are part of this new normal. Three things that we must embrace as normal every day. We have a new identity. We have a new reckoning. And we have a new presentation every single day. Verses 1 through 10 talks about this new identification. This is a hot topic for today, is it not? Identity. What's your identity? How do you identify? How do you present yourself to the world? The labels we use to define who we are, the labels we use to bring value and purpose and meaning to our life. The big question is, what are we placing our identity in? What are we allowing to identify us to the world? From what we do, we derive our identity. Now, Paul in the old self, the Roman one self, the ones that were suppressing the truth, being taken captive by lies, will work to identify themselves with the things of the world. It's the things of the world that they will identify with because they know nothing else. They'll find purpose and meaning in the things of the world. Find their value. Maybe you're still in some of this. You're still struggling with who you are. How the world sees you, understands you. For some, identity is taken into their career. It's the all-encompassing. That's the biggest thing about you is your career. That drive for money, that occupation. For some today, it's the gender sexuality question. For some, it's race. For some, it's parenting. Right? You identify as a mom. You identify as a dad. And your identity gets all wrapped up in the life of your kids. And if they succeed, you succeed. If they fail, you fail. Because you have identified with them. They are your identity. Wrong. That's a lot of pressure to put on a 5-year-old. Where I live becomes your identity. You got to have the right house in the right neighborhood. And you identify with that neighborhood, with that city, with that state. You've got it all wrapped up and I've got to be in the right location. No, you don't. Or where I come from. While these are all things that are important to who we are as a person, they can't be the most important thing. They can't be the thing that identifies us to the rest of the world. The world attaches value to all those things and tries to find identity and meaning in them that in the end are really just secondary, at best, to who we are. Listen to what Paul says about his pedigree, his fleshly identity. He says in Philippians chapter 3, if someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. To a Jew, all of these things were top bar. Circumcised on the 8th day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But then he says, whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. That same thing Eric preached on last week. The righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. Paul said, I've got all these things that I could claim as my identity. I'm a Hebrew of Hebrews. I was circumcised on the eighth day. I am a Pharisee when it comes to the law. More knowledgeable. I even my zeal, the way I lived it out, I was crucifying Christians. I was killing them, going in, ransacking. I was protecting the church, protecting the temple, protecting Hebrew way. He said, but I consider all that, all those worldly things, all those worldly identities, I consider garbage to knowing Christ, to having his righteousness placed on my account, to being called a child of God. He introduces himself to Rome in this letter. He introduces himself, Paul, a servant of Christ. That's his identity. I'm a servant of Christ. Nothing else matters. Nothing else even comes close to my identity that I now have with Jesus. Galatians chapter 3, Paul says, so in Christ Jesus, you are all. So believers, this morning, you are all children of God through faith. That's your identity. You're a child of God. For all of you were baptized into Christ, have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, nationality, race, doesn't matter. Neither slave nor free, status in life, job, career, doesn't matter. Nor is there male or female, gender, sexuality, doesn't matter. For you are all one in Christ. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. The moment you accept Christ, your identity changes. And we need to embrace that identity as a child of God, that we are not identified by worldly things, by the flesh, by the things that the world says is important, Paul says is garbage. I don't want to be identified as garbage. Jesus is my Savior. Jesus is my King. Jesus is my Lord. I'm a child of God. That's all you need to know about me. That's how I want to present myself. That's how I want the world to know me, to see me. The new believer, the Romans 3 self, Christ gives us this new identity, and we identify with him. This identity has nothing to do with anything in this world. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, so from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. We don't look at anyone from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. A new creation, a new person, a new identity. By faith in Christ Jesus. The old has gone. The Romans 1 self, gone. The new, the Romans 3 self, has come. Many don't understand this change of identity. You were never taught. I wasn't. I accepted Christ at the age of 12 at an old-time revival that our church had week-long. We went to church every single night. And we heard the same guy every single night. Well, something along the lines of Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday must have sunk in because Sunday, decision day, something grabbed me. I was a good kid. I was a moral kid. I followed the rules. My mom and dad made sure I knew what the rules were and that I followed them, and I did. Very compliant. I was a good kid. But something that day reminded me that I'm not good enough for God's standard. And I was a sinner in need of a Savior. And I went forward and accepted Christ that day. Put my faith in Jesus. Was baptized immediately. Ushered with like seven other people. We went right up and we were baptized that day. Sadly, nobody ever took the time to come alongside me and explain what just happened. And as I began to go through life, I realized that at the age of 12, I just checked a box that got me into heaven. And it was kind of like, you've accepted Jesus, great, get baptized. Got baptized, great, all right, go out. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Be kind, be nice, be loved. I was already doing those things. I was already treating people the way I wanted to be treated. I was already being nice. I was already being kind. I was getting good grades. Doesn't that count? I wasn't a straight A student, but I was good. Straight B, probably. Good enough, right? Nobody came in and explained to me that from that moment on, your life is different. It's changed. Jesus comes in and Jesus now wants to do some amazing works in your life. Paul asks an incredible question in verse 1, talking about understanding this identity, because to me, it was like, well, okay, I did sin. I wasn't a perfect kid. I was a good kid. And I did do things occasionally. And after I accepted Christ, it was great to have all those things forgiven, but I found that I just continued to do them. Nothing really changed. No one said. And doesn't it make sense that if I'm saved because of sin? Because what we really want to hear, right, is the really great salvation stories. You know, the guy that was into drugs and he murdered his neighbor and he went into, and then he found Jesus and now he's a. That's the story we all think we should be able to have. Not the good kid who accepted Jesus and is now forgiven. And so Paul asked this question because my question was, well, can I just, you know, go on being like I was, ask forgiveness every time and I'm good, right? Paul says, should we go on sinning so that grace may increase? The more I sin, the more grace, right? The worse of a human being I am, the more depraved I am, the better Jesus looks when he forgives me, right? So I should just go right on sinning. No. Paul says, heck to the no. If Paul was a swearing man, he'd have sworn right there. By absolute no means is that the way life is to be lived. Once you've accepted Christ, once you've placed your faith in him, life is now different. You can't go back to the old way of doing things. And Paul says, why? Because we died to sin. You see, in that moment of putting faith in Christ, we died to sin. We are dead to sin. Dead men don't die. Dead men don't sin. And when sin comes knocking, you're dead. When temptation comes, you're dead. Play dead. Don't entertain it. Don't breathe life into it. Understand that receiving God's free gift of justification, that right standing with God, means that while we are made alive in our spirit, we have to die to some things from the old self. We inherited a sin nature from Adam and Eve. But our new identification is not with Adam the sinner. Our new identification is with God, that he has given us. Our identification is with Christ the righteous. Paul says this identity with Christ, what the new identification looks like, is best illustrated through the act of baptism. If you've never been baptized, pay close attention. It's a significant step in solidifying your new identity. The symbolism behind it, baptism is the act of publicly declaring your new identity as a follower of Christ. Baptism doesn't produce anything. It's not something magical in the water. It's an outward sign of the inward change. It's symbolic of identifying with Christ in his death. He died for us. We die with him. That's why we do it this way. This is why you're in the water and you go down. You die. You're buried beneath the water, symbolizing that you died with Christ. You were placed in the tomb with him, and now you come out in newness of life. That we identify with his death, we identify with his life. He is my identity now, living for him. Don't you know, verse 3, that all of us who were baptized in Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Our new identification shares in Christ's resurrection to life. The coming out of the baptismal water. If we have been united with him in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. Pay close attention to verse 6. For we know that our old self, that old sinful, wicked, suppressing the truth self, was crucified with him. So that the body ruled by sin might be rendered powerless. That we should no longer be slaves to sin. Because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. The old self. That phrase actually refers to the corpse, to a dead self, the dead body of sin, powerless. If we're powerless to sin, that means it's to abolish it, it's to render it unemployed, inactive. Sin comes looking for a job, I'm not hiring. Gone, done. Our new identification with Christ renders sin ineffective in our life. We've been freed from the power of sin. It no longer has mastery over us. We've been given power to overcome sin, to say no when tempted. When sin shows up in your life, he no longer sees the Adam in you. He sees the Christ in you. The new identification, and that is great news. But there's still a problem. I'm not sinless. You know, sometimes when sin comes knocking, it in. I harbor an attitude from the old self. I go back to an action or a behavior that was part of the old me, and I play around with it again. This whole idea of what Paul is saying here, that we're dead to sin, we die, that doesn't really describe my life. I'm pretty sure it doesn't describe any of you. I know some of you. And it doesn't. So Paul says, what's the solution to that? What is it? Because my life doesn't really mirror or reflect this new identity all the time. It does sometimes. It does a lot of time. I've changed some things. Christ came in and look at verse 11. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. The key to this whole power over the sin nature is not in a one-time check the box. Now, I know people that they've struggled. They had sin issues in their life. They had addictions. They had things that were dragging them down. And when they accepted Christ, they were released freely from all of that. That just all disappeared. There's no temptation there anymore. It's a done deal. But that doesn't happen for everyone in every area. Sometimes we have to, what Paul says, count yourselves dead to sin. The key to this whole power of the sin nature is our considering ourselves dead when sin shows up. That word count yourselves, or I like the translation, I don't remember which one it is, that says reckon yourselves, means to count something as finished or complete. And the verb carries with it a continuous action. You see, it's not a one-time check the box. It's a daily reckoning. We have a new reckoning. When we wake up in the morning, reckon yourself dead to sin. When temptation comes, reckon yourself dead to sin. It's ongoing. The struggle is ongoing. Because while we consider ourselves dead to sin, we all know by experience that sin nature is still alive. It's just now we've been given the Holy Spirit to dwell within us and the power and the ability to overcome it. That's the change. That's the difference. Count yourselves dead. This is not a one and done reckoning. It's a life of dying to self, dying to the flesh, dying to sin. Sin is not dead, but you are dead to sin. Sin is still active. That sin nature is going to be kicking and screaming until the day Jesus comes and we get new resurrected bodies. When that completion of salvation, remember Paul says, continue to work out your salvation, not work for, continue to work it out. Continue to live out this process of sanctification, of being changed, of being transformed, of saying no to sin, yes to God. Daily, reckoning. And here's the hard part. Sometimes we think, I placed faith in Jesus, now I won't struggle with sin anymore. And then when I do, I lose faith. God hates me. No, that's a lie. God doesn't necessarily like what you did, but he's there to forgive you if you confess your sins. He's faithful and just to forgive us, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness at any moment, at any time, for anything. A brand new start every day. Sin is still alive, but now with Jesus, through Jesus, we have the power to overcome sin. Have you ever thought there's a part of you, a sin part of you that you battle daily, that you battle all the time, that raises its head? Can you imagine life overcoming that? Today, reckon it dead. Reckon yourselves dead to that sin. Now, I'll guarantee you, tomorrow, you'll have to reckon yourself dead to it again. That's okay. The more times you do it, the more victory you get. Eventually, that's going to be weaker and weaker and weaker and weaker. No longer are you a slave to sin, but a new normal of overcoming sin. The new normal is that we never excuse sinful behavior. We just deal with it. In ourselves, we deal with it. As I often say, we are not sinless. But by the power of the Holy Spirit, over time, we sin less and less. That's the new normal. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, talks about a sin that so easily entangles. And I believe that while we are all born with a sin nature, okay, every one of us is born with a sin nature, that sin nature manifests itself differently in every person. Because my sin that I struggle with is probably different than yours. It may not be. But your sin may be different than the person across the aisle from you in the other chair. Maybe person, if you're online, maybe person different than the person sitting on the other end of the couch than you. We all have sin nature, and that sin nature shows itself in sinful ways different with every one of us. And I think the writer of Hebrews says that's the sin that so easily entangles. It's from birth. It's like you were born a liar. If you have trouble telling the truth, you know, you don't have to teach a kid to lie. And there are some kids that are just really good at it, right? I think that's the sin that so easily entangles. I think that's just how that sin nature manifests itself in that person. As a sinner, maybe a cheater, maybe an adulterer, a lustful person. It seems like there's one sin that just trips them up over and over and over again. And they can't seem to overcome it. And eventually we just say, I'm just going to have to live with this. No, you don't. Render yourselves dead to it. And the next time it comes up, render yourself dead again. And the next time it comes up, render yourself dead again. And the next time you stumble and give in, confess your sin to God, and he will forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness, and render yourself dead again. And I believe that over time, that's going to get weaker and weaker and weaker and weaker. Because that's not your identity. Your identity is not that sin. It's not that failure. It's not that part of your life. Your identity is Christ. Before Christ, that is your identity. Before Christ, that sin that so easily entangles you is how you are known. But not with Jesus. You have one. In a little bit, at the end of the service, we're going to lead with a closing song. And I'm just going to invite you at that point. And you already know, as soon as I said a sin that so easily entangles you, one that trips you up over and over, it's in your head. It came right to the forefront. You know what it is. I'm going to invite you to come right down here and kill it. Render it useless. Complete. Reckon it so. And I'm going to pray over you that when we leave here, it stays dead. It might. It might not. You may have to reckon it again and again and again and again. Keep doing. Keep fighting. Fight with others. If you don't want to come by yourself, bring someone with you that will stand in support of you. Because you have one. You have a sin that is easily entangles you, and it is keeping you from experiencing all of the things that Jesus has for you. And maybe it's gone on so long, you've just accepted it. It's just who I am. Mm-mm. It's not who you are now. It's your old identity, not your new. Because Paul tells us in verses 12 to 14 that now we present ourselves in a new way. We have a new presentation. He says, therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer the parts of your bodies to sin as instruments of weakness, but rather offer yourselves, present yourselves to God as instruments of righteousness. Present our bodies to Christ. We give ourselves, every area of our life, to Him. There's not an area that He doesn't want to come in and manifest His Spirit. This means replacing the old habits with new habits. It means living a life now in a direction towards Jesus, chasing after Him, old self with new self. It's the spiritual disciplines we talk about. The old habits are replaced now with Bible reading, study, prayer, fasting, worship, community with other believers. That's the new life. That's the new normal. Confession of sin to one another, the new normal. See, if you hide, if you hide, it hides. One of the biggest things is if you confess your sin to one another in a loving community, it's a big step in getting over it. Satan doesn't know what to do with that because now you've got a whole army of people on your side, praying, walking with accountability. We're never meant to do life alone. We're never meant to battle the old self alone. We're never even meant to battle the old self with just the Holy Spirit in us, but to use each and every one of us. Now, I'm not going to ask you to come forward and with a microphone confess the sin that so easily, I'm not doing that. But we can come, confess that there is one. And maybe there's a group of people that you can rely on, that you can trust to help carry you through that to victory. This new presentation, it's a refusal to allow sin to rule over us. That moment by moment striving to live like Christ. Some days it's all you can do to render it dead. Some days you flourish. Bob Petty, our district superintendent, has a phrase that I don't know if he got it from somewhere else. I've only ever heard him say it. I love the phrase. As he's praying for people, as he's praying for pastors, as he's praying for new ones who are walking through licensing or ordination, he always prays that they don't play with dead things. And that's what Paul is saying. Let's stop playing with dead things. Sin is a dead thing. Render ourselves dead to it. Stop picking it up and playing with dead things. I remember one of my kids coming in from the backyard. They were outside playing, and they come in and go, "Daddy, look what I found. Look what I found. It was a dead bird." I'm like, "Get rid of it. Drop it. Don't play with dead things. Go now. Disinfect your hands. Let's bleach them. You're going to..." Sometimes we treat sin that way in our life. We know it's a dead thing. We know it has absolutely no value to us. In fact, it's going to deteriorate us. It's going to do harm to us. It's a bad idea with bad consequences. This morning, before God and all these witnesses, declare, "I'm not playing with dead things." That's Paul's new presentation. Verse 13 is key to all that we do. It says, "Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness." He's basically saying, stop playing with dead things. But rather, here's the option. Here's what you can do. Offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life. And offer every part of yourself to him as an instrument of righteousness. Allow him to redeem that sin. You know, God can take the most shameful part of your life, redeem it, and use it to his glory. Unless you bury it and continue to play with it, then he can't. But someone, as you gain victory over this sin, there's going to be someone in their walk that's struggling with it, that needs help, that you can come along and say, "Let me walk beside you. I know where you are. I fought that battle. I found victory. I have overcome." That's normal. Overcoming is normal. The battle is normal. The daily reckoning is normal. Playing with dead things, not normal. Not what Paul wants for us. It's a complete presentation of my life to God, and I am at his disposal. I am his instrument, his tool, or his weapon in some cases. That God is building his church, and we are the tools he is using. I want to invite the worship team to come up. And today, Christian, believer, you have a new identity. A new identification as a follower of Christ. And in it, you will find meaning and purpose and ultimate satisfaction. But this morning, you have a new reckoning. You have to declare yourself dead to sin. To that sin that so easily entangles us, that still has breath. You all have it. We have it. I have it. This morning we're going to kill it. Destroy that part of your old self, your dead self. We all have some area this morning, and I want to give you right now, as we sing this last song, the opportunity to come. You come. No one's asking, what brought you here this morning? You come. Bring it to God. Reckon yourself dead. I'm going to pray over you. And then we're going to sing another song that is total victory, because we walk out of here victorious this morning. Amen. Father, this morning I ask that you would give courage and boldness, that we would render complete, useless, destroyed that sin that entangles us, that wraps itself around our heart, around our life, around our mind, the lie that we believe. Father, give us each courage to say no, to make that public declaration that from this day on I identify as a child of Christ, a child of God. This morning you come. Let's stand together. Thank you.
treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love.
Father, thank you for Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, for the Holy Spirit who convicts, who brings life to dead souls. Father, my prayer for those who have come forward this morning, you know each one. You know what part of them they need to die to. Give them the power, give them the courage through Jesus Christ, through the Holy Spirit's work, to declare victory this morning. Father, they will leave here different than they came in because they have encountered you, they have engaged you. They stand on truth. They no longer want to play with dead things. Father, I pray against the enemy who will want to wreak havoc this afternoon in their life and convince them that this was all a sham. Father, surround them with your army of angels. Empower them with your authority over dead things. Thank you for redemption. That this is not the end of the story, but there is beauty from ashes. There is resurrection life from this area that you want to redeem and bring about good things. Father, we celebrate you this morning. We celebrate victory for each of these lives. In Jesus' name, amen. The song we're going to sing is actually our benediction that I want to leave you with, but a couple things. During this last song, we'll receive the offering. The offering you can do online, you can text, you can drop it in the boxes at the back, and really it all goes for what Petula was sharing, the 700 other missionaries we have all around the world, keeps those things going. So we appreciate, we thank you for your faithfulness in giving on a regular basis. Also, next Saturday is our trunk or treat. So we have plenty of trunks. We can use some more. What we really need is the candy that we're going to hand out. So if you didn't bring it this morning, feel free to drop it off anytime at the church this week. And then next Sunday is our connection lunch. For anyone who's new, I say new since COVID because we haven't done one since then. Just a great chance to meet staff, meet elders, some of the leaders, ask any questions that you have of us. But this is what I want to leave you with this morning. Hunter, lead us out. We'll be right back.
I needed a rescue, my sin was heavy. The chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healer.